Everybody, let me kick off with just a couple of minutes introduction. Just a few thoughts on where we are as a project and what the big rocks are that we are busy consuming and shaping and laying into foundations. Thank you very much, Michael, for the kickoff and the intro. And also thank you to the guys who've organized this online summit. It's great to see how much diversity we get of participation. I'm happy to answer any questions that you guys might have here, but also want to encourage you to dive into the relevant sessions and help shape what we do as a community throughout the course of the summit. There are amazing things going on, and we need your insights, we need your help, we need your ideas, and we need your muscle. Right, so I had a couple of thoughts. First, I wanted to start with, where we are with Ubuntu for humans. Being a project for human beings is very much a strong part of our ethos. I think it's why so many people feel that participating in Ubuntu really benefits their communities, the people they care about, both personally at a family sort of friendship level, but also just in the spirit of helping humanity get over its various challenges and griefs. And for me, this is an incredibly exciting time in that regard. We have a phone. The images are coming together beautifully. The industrial feedback is really solid. I have seen no sign that there's any blinking on the road to actually releasing to manufacture. The team is working furiously, and thank you very much to the extraordinary contributors and participants that we have on that project. If we pull this off, it is going to be the only place in the world that you can literally watch day by day as a phone platform takes shape, which is, I think, a really important, really phenomenal thing to bring to the world. There is an amazing developer community over there. The SDK is shaped up nicely, and I don't know if you're paying attention, but the scope, is it Scope Throwdown Challenge, is underway at the moment, and there's some really, really cool scopes being developed. If we can make the Ubuntu phone something that people feel is just the fastest way to get access to all the goodness of stuff that's, quickly available on the net, then we will have pulled something really magical off. So scopes, scopes, scopes. And those of you who haven't yet taken a look, dive in and start over there. It's very, very cool what's being done. There are scopes for search engines, scopes for all kinds of content, scopes for all kind of news sites or discussion sites. It's a really interesting way to think about presenting information that's lighter than a traditional application. The more different perspectives we have on scopes, the cooler it's going to be. I do want to leave you with a tease, which is that we're going to announce very shortly a developer program in partnership with one of the world's biggest telecommunications companies. So I think this project has legs. I think there are going to be millions of people who really appreciate the work that we do on this phone. I think we're entering a time when being a small, independent, community-oriented platform is really valuable. We're seeing the trust in personal computing is hard to find. I think this is a platform that can deliver a new kind of trust between people who need to use, who'd be part of the digital era and the world around them. So well done, and thank you very much to everybody who is making that move forward. Obviously, the convergence plan keeps going forward, and I was delighted that in Utopic we saw an official Ubuntu Desktop Next package. Now it is super, super early. You're looking at code that's essentially, all most people's focus on that code is for the phone. But there are people that are starting to work on taking that code and making it a great desktop experience. And that's not the same as a phone, right? So sometimes people say, oh, well, I don't want to run system on my desktop, and that's kind of missing the point. What you want to run is you want to run an experience which gracefully transitions through the different faces, through those different phases of your personal computing day. I'm absolutely convinced if I look at Moore's Law, if I look at trajectory for the silicon, both from Intel and from the ARM ecosystem that's going into the next wave of devices and the wave after that, we're going to see phone class CPUs that are perfectly capable of driving a quad HD desktop platform. So I want us to be delivering that future first, and we need all the help we can get. So if you care about the desktop, just the desktop, and you want to work on a crisp, clean, fresh code base that's got really professional infrastructure around it, supporting a really professional development process, even if you're not a phone guy, come and have a look at the work that Desktop Next team is doing. You may have seen support for Mir landing in GTK. That's very cool, and thank you to the people who led that, and thank you to the GTK community for being open to it. I'd like to see support for all of the major toolkits, which let us bring all of the major free software applications to a convergent desktop, and I think that's a really incredible trick if we can pull it off, just in terms of giving people a brand new and really powerful new visionary option in the ever diverse, ever colorful Linux desktop scene. So patch is welcome. Our goal is to have a Unity 8 convergent desktop as an option available to users, not as the default, but as an option available to users for 1604 LTS. So we are well on our way, and it's a lot of fun. Everybody that I talk to who participates in that project says they have a blast. There is a very minimal troll factor, so climb in and have fun. Okay, so that's where we are, I think, on Ubuntu for humans. Let's talk a little bit about the cloud. Some of you might have noticed the announcement by Google and Canonical that Ubuntu is now on the Google Compute Engine, which we're super excited about. It's a cloud that has some unique characteristics, and it's worth taking a look at, see if it fits your project or your particular needs. And the Google guys have been, we've built a good relationship. If there's anything that we can do to make Ubuntu better on the Google Cloud, I'm very confident that we can find the right people at Google to discuss that with. So if you have ideas or suggestions, then please pass that on. So that really rounds out the list of clouds. We've been on Amazon for a long time. I'm really proud of the work that we do on Azure. The Microsoft team has been super credible, super thoughtful in their engagement with us from the very beginning. And I think there's increasingly signs that Microsoft is now willing to embrace open source in profound new ways. They've just announced the open sourcing of .NET, which is a fantastic step forward. The more we can convince companies to participate in growing the body of public code, the better it is for all of us. And so certainly within our community, I think it's important to avoid obvious snide digs at the past, and focus on what we're trying to do, which is grow the body of code which is available to innovators all over the world, teachers, innovators, students, learners. And so I'm really proud of what we're doing with Microsoft and Azure in that regard, and delighted that work is now spreading beyond Azure into one of the world's largest software companies. So that's kind of great, and I think members of this community should feel proud of the work that they've done and the way that's helped create that change in mindset in possibly a modest way, but still we should take some credit for it. Joyent, Sigma Cloud, and many more. So Ubuntu is now pretty universally across all of the clouds that matter. If there are clouds out there that we're not on that you think are important, please give us a shout in the right channel on IRC and help us prioritize the conversations that we're having with cloud companies. It does take quite a lot of work to get Ubuntu onto a cloud, so it's not something that happens sort of trivially or instantly. We had a problem in the beginning with like really bad hacked up copies of Ubuntu on a ton of clouds, but we're cleaning that up so that pretty much if Ubuntu's on a cloud, you have a promise that it's going to work. It's going to work to a very high standard. It's going to be immediately available, updated, and all of those good things. And we try to work to optimize the way we do updates and things to minimize the cost to you of being on a cloud. Different techniques work for different clouds, obviously. For people who are looking to build their own clouds, I think that's now really a very credible path forward. And there is an OpenStack installer that we'd really like feedback on. It's all open source. It essentially lets you walk through the installation components of an OpenStack cloud, it has an opinionated view initially of how it would map that out to a bunch of hardware, but in fact it leaves it up to you to decide exactly what component you want to put where. It's all using the power of Juju, the magic of Juju, but it's got a nice console-based, so SSH-friendly, server-friendly, cloud-friendly GUI that the team have put on it, and I'd love to get your feedback on that. I know they'd love your feedback as well. I'll be meeting that team next week, so we'll be very happy to pass on any feedback, and happy if they tell me that they got lots of feedback. So all you need to do is you need to get a couple of machines. It does have a mode to support installing OpenStack on a single machine. If you've got a nice beefy laptop and you want to run OpenStack on your laptop, the cloud installer, the OpenStack installer, will do that for you. But ideally, what you want to do is take 5 or 6 machines, stick them in MAZ, and then point that installer at it, and then you'll bring up that cloud in 15-20 minutes. It's really quick, really easy, really nice. You may also have announced that Canonical has an autopilot for OpenStack. So that's part of our management offering that all of our customers get access to. And I'd love to get feedback on that from the community as well. It's not open source, but the text-based installer that I've described is open source. And they're both using the same underpinnings. So if you use the autopilot and then remove Landscape, you end up with an open source cloud that has all of the same charms and so on and so forth underneath it, and packages, obviously. So what else is there? MAZ 1.7. We're looking to SRU MAZ 1.7 into both Trustee and Utopic. So feedback on that would be super useful, please. It's a huge leap forward from the MAZ which is in Trustee 1.5, and that team has done a tremendous amount of work. So if you want a tool that lets you, you know, quickly install Windows, quickly install RHEL, CentOS, Ubuntu, Debian, and so on, that's a great way to go. And we'd be very interested in your feedback. Again, I'll be seeing the MAZ team next week, so I'd love to hear that they got a long list of feedback and ideas from members of the community. So definitely something to go work on. I pretty much feel like, you know, we really have set the pace for the industry in that. We started work on MAZ, back in 1104 type days. And now suddenly it's very cool to do physical provisioning. And I still think MAZ has the right set of ideas, the best set of ideas to express your hardware, your collection of hardware, as effectively a cloud that people can just pull from based on constraints. So go have a look at it. There's pretty great stuff there. And once again, it's a nice area that Ubuntu is leading in an important piece of work. Again, on the cloud, some of you guys may be using Docker for this, or Docker for that, or Docker for anything, or Docker for everything. Docker's kind of everywhere. Very keen to get your ideas on how we support Docker better. One thing that I'm committed to do is that we will bring to Ubuntu all of the different Docker orchestration systems. So we've got charms, Juju charms for Kubernetes. We'll have Juju charms for all of the major orchestration systems, and if there's one that we miss on the list, we'd love to get a charm from you for that. It's really easy to create charms now, much easier than packaging, and most of the sort of common pieces are in really great shape now. So all of the sort of common messaging systems and things like etcd and databases and so on, all the glue that you might need is likely in really good nick from a charming point of view. So someone did a Reddit charm in just a week or two because all of the other pieces that they needed were already there. So now you can choose to deploy Reddit if you want to fork Reddit, which is certainly not a quote that I'd like widely spread around the internet, and certainly not on Reddit. Hello, everyone from Reddit. Right, and then you might have seen our announcement of the successor to LexC, which is LexD. And it's not really a successor because what we're doing is we're taking LexC and making that the client. LexD is the server, the daemon, and that's all about creating a container-based hypervisor. So super, super fast virtual machines, effectively. As long as they're Linux virtual machines, you'll be able to run CentOS, RHEL, SUSE, Debian, and Ubuntu, all on Ubuntu, and do it really brilliantly on any machine from any other machine with a nice LexC client. So if you're interested in that, I bet there'll be sessions on it during the summit. It's going to be pretty awesome stuff. So that's Ubuntu for humans and Ubuntu for the cloud. And I just want to wrap up by inviting people to tell me and tell us what you think it would take to make a great Ubuntu for internet things. So obviously everybody's interested in the Internet of Things, but I've noticed a ton of people doing cool stuff on in embedded type environments with Ubuntu, and that varies from companies that are making switches and routers based on Ubuntu to companies that are making tiny little hackable gadgets based on Ubuntu, and I'm really interested in that. I think supporting innovation and creativity is really cool, and a lot of the smartest, kind of most creative geeks that I know are playing with Arduino, playing with tiny little embedded boards. There's now hundreds of them that you can get, pies of every kind of fruit you can imagine, and it's worth us making sure that Ubuntu is cool for those guys. So tell us what you would like us to do to make a great Ubuntu for the era of things.